Bonjour à tous, merci d'être venus nombreux à ce séminaire. On a le plaisir d'accueillir Joël Martelot, CNRS. Donc Joël, j'en suis arrivé à un point où le temps passe et j'ai pas trop de boulot pour le présenter parce que je me souviens à peu près de ce qu'il avait fait. D'accord ? Il a fait sa thèse avec Benoît, Roman et José Bico à l'ESPCI sur les fractures. Ensuite, postdoc avec Pedro Rice au MIT, puis avec son pote Pierre-Thomas Brun à Princeton. Et puis, je me souviens aussi que j'étais content quand tu as eu le CNRS à l'USTI. Donc aujourd'hui, tu vas nous parler de Morphing Soft Structure with Instabilities. Et c'est à toi, Joël.
Cool. Thank you. So I do it in English. That's the deal. Ouais. So I'll talk about Morphing Soft Structures with Instabilities. So I'm in Marseille, in USTI. And so the basic question is, there are a lot of people looking at ways of going out of rigid robotics and trying to do soft actuation. And a good way to do soft actuation is to look at biological structures, because, for example, if we look at the expansion of wings in insects, we see that it's a remarkable change of shape. On quite fast change of shape in a biological structure, and usually those actuation process they are fast, robust, energy efficient, and so on. And so it's a topic of interest for many people in materials and solid mechanics and fluid mechanics to, for example, manipulate objects to move or to morph to different shapes. And essentially, the things I'm interested in are questions in which the motor is very simple. It's, for example, a change in pressure, but it plays on a structure which has some anisotropy, and so this implies a function. And usually, also in a biological system, the actuators are organized in networks, and so there is this question of how we can program the function by playing with the network. Okay, so this is a little bit the introduction, and I will show you a few different topics in which we are trying to play with this idea. And the first one is about making elastic films with different material properties at different space. And so we are calling this pixelated elastic films. It's something we've done with Pierre-Thomas and the students in Princeton. And so essentially the problem is that we are pouring some viscous liquid elastomer on an LHO cell, but the LHO cell has some sources, so some holes on the top plate. And so what we see is that the fluid invade the LHO cell, and we can make those kind of architected structures that then, because this polymer can be is curing, essentially we can peel and we can get elastic structures with and so the first thing we try to understand is what is the dynamic of invasion of this viscous liquid inside the cell. And so if we are looking at the variation of the radius with time, we can play with different viscosity, like silicon oil with different viscosities, and we can play with the thickness between the two plates, and we see a bunch of variation of the radius with time, which is basically increasing in time. And if we are just looking at what are the forces which are at play, the motor is the Laplace pressure gradient, which essentially scales with the surface tension of the liquid over the radius times the thickness times the gap of the cell. And this is resisted by the viscous dissipation, which scales as the viscosity of the liquid times the velocity over the thickness to the square. And so just in scaling, we see that the radius could increase as the square root of time, with gamma h over mu. And so if we take into account the waiting angle on the initial radius of the source, we can find how the radius increases in time, and we can correct for potential effect of gravity if the height of the bath is slightly higher essentially on that we can't neglect gravity anymore. So what we can see is that if we plot the increase of the radius with this dimensionless time, now we kind of collapse the different experimental observation, and we see that we get with this simple description of the radius, we get a quite nice description of the variation of the radius with time. So this is for viscous liquid, but now we can include the effect of curing, because our polymer is something that for which the viscosity change in time. And so what we have to take into account is just the integration of the viscosity in time. And if we are looking at the variation of the viscosity with time for this specific polymer, what we see is that essentially we get a long time for which the viscosity is quite constant, and then it increases quite rapidly. This is quite well described by just a simple law as a viscosity, the initial viscosity on some divergence with a critical curing time to C. And so if we take this viscosity into account, we can derive what is the final radius that we expect, and check that for three different polymers here with a different viscosity on curing time, we can kind of capture what is the final radius that we will get on one source. Okay, so now the question is, what is happening when we get several sources? And so we can play with two polymers which are the same, we just color them, they have the same viscosity, and what we see is that essentially they tend to invade the cell and to meet. When they meet, they don't they basically live their own life, and we see that essentially the area we can compute the area of the final elastic structure that we get. And just looking at simple geometric argument, essentially looking at what is the shape which corresponds to the two radius, to the two final radius of each source, we can describe what is the total area of the structure. And another thing we can try to characterize is the velocity at which the two sources meet. So essentially it's zipping at the velocity that you can see here in green. So it's quite fast compared to the velocity that you get when the radius is just increasing without meeting another source. On with simple argument, just again looking at viscous forces versus capillary forces, we can expect that this zipping length goes as the square root of time, which seems to be the case, not at the very beginning of the meeting, because it's a 3D problem at that time, but a little bit later, essentially. We seem to see it's something which goes like the square root of time. So this is for two sources, and we can play with now sources with different shapes, and we get other kind of boundaries. And the problem is just to look at the time at which the two sources will meet, so we can compute what is the front which comes from each source, so where the front is on determine essentially where is the boundary where the these two times match. And so for if we are playing only with the same viscosity, essentially this goes back to a transformation which is called the watershed transformation. But if we are playing with different viscosities, basically we can just easily by predicting this position of the front, predict where the two sources will meet. And so this is enough, essentially this geometrical construction is enough to predict where the two sources will meet. And so now we can make those kind of structure. So this is with two different viscosities, and so the interesting thing is now those two polymers, they also have different Young modulus. And so if we are saying on trying to pressurize this structure, essentially we can get shapes just by like programming or putting different elastic properties in the field. So this is for two sources. We can play with more sources, and what we see is that essentially the same way you will meet, but as soon as you are meeting, essentially you create a bubble, and the pressure in the bubble is too big for the flow to continue. And so you encapsulate a bubble. And just with the same geometrical simple argument, essentially you can draw the position of the circle which corresponds to the for where the diameter is the distance between the two center of the sources. And we can like predict what is the shape of the structure. And you can do this on a much larger, for more cells, essentially. And and you can also play with different way of paving the space to get this kind of more complicated shapes. So we can encapsulate this bubble, but then if we want to get shapes which are connected, one way to do this is to simply do a vent in order to remove the pressure and then the capillary flow continue essentially, and it meets up and it does a beautiful geometrical shapes. And if you are playing with a slightly more complicated disposition of the sources, you can essentially build a Voronoi tessellation of the position of the sources, and this gives you where you should put the vent essentially in order to get a continuous thing. Okay, and so this is it for this story. So you can build also funnier geometrical shapes. And so this is trying to make an architected film in a plane. And then another story which is quite related, which we also did with Pierre-Thomas Brun, Étienne Jean Bonpouillet, who is now almost back in France, and Trevor Jones, who is a PhD student in Princeton, is to play with bubbles in ouais, of course. Pour on a plate?
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, you could get something which is probably quite injecting or. Yeah. So. Yeah, so I think the the only interest of doing it with the surface tension is essentially, well, first it's passive, so it's kind of nice, and then also you kind of get this zipping. You can make a little bit of error essentially and still get geometry which is quite nice. While I think if you were doing faster, I don't, maybe you need to be more careful, I think, to get the same result. But the geometrical argument that I showed is true for many other systems. Actually, if you play with Skittles, I don't like do the kind of you put them in a you put them in a petri dish, you pour some water, you will see some kind of front because the color ring of the Skittle will diffuse inside the water, and you will see something which is quite similar. Good. So in this case, what we are doing is we are essentially injecting the same polymer in a tube, and then we inject a bubble, and then we just wait. And so it's the same polymer, so it has the same kind of properties, where the viscosity essentially is constant for a while and then rockets up. And we peel this structure, and so the elegant thing is that if we now increase the pressure inside the structure, we see that makes a small dripper. And so we wanted to try to understand what is the typical geometry of the tube that we get. And so what we are doing is essentially we are pushing a bubble. It's a very classical problem, which is Bretherton problem. And so this defines what is the initial thickness of the film in the tube. And this we can get just matching viscous effects to capillary effects, and to get the length on which that thing plays a role, essentially you have to match the static and the dynamic meniscus. And so this is all very classical. And what we get is that the film that we are depositing essentially scale with the radius of the tube times the capillary number to the 2/3. And there is a small correction when we are looking at a film in which the initial thickness is of the order of the radius that was derived by Ossius and Quéré. And so what we get is essentially, like in the classical paper, that the thickness goes with this capillary to the 2/3. And what is interesting for us is that essentially, if we go fast enough, we see that the thickness is quite independent on the velocity of the bubble. And so it means that even if we are not super careful, again, which is something that we like to be, we have something which is quite robust in terms of what is the thickness that we are depositing. And so then, that film... So I didn't put the prefactor, but and I don't think there was the prefactor actually in this paper, but yes, it's with the prefactor you get. Sorry, I'm not going in the right direction. It should be not. Yes, I don't think it's. It depends on. Exactly. And so we can look at then essentially this film will drain, and so a way to try to capture what is the the drainage velocity on the top is essentially there is two scales. There is the initial thickness of the film, and there is a typical time scale, which scale like a mu r over rho g square. So we can non-dimensionalize 2D liquefaction equation. So this was given by Takagi and Eppert. And also the solution at the apex is known. It's something which goes like 1 over 150, essentially. And what we can do is a nonlinear expansion for small angles to try to capture a little bit how the thickness varies with the angle at the apex. And what we get is something like this, and which depends on what is the shape of the initial coating. And if you put back the dimension, what you can see is that at long time, in for large time approximation, so essentially for time which are large compared to the initial drainage time, you can forget about the one essentially, and so you forget about the initial thickness of the coating, and so you get a final thickness essentially which is independent to initial condition and which has a weak dependence with the angle. And this is something we've also seen. It's exactly the same problem, just in a cylindrical way, that we looked with Pedro Reis previously, and Pierre Thomas, and so on. So this is relevant for Easter, for the fabrication of shells. So the same way we can make thin shells, which are essentially independent to initial condition and have a weak angle dependence. Okay, and so we can again incur the so this is for viscous liquid, but of course we can do the same thing, taking into account the viscosity, and so we can predict what is the final thickness at the top. And so then we have a problem in which we are essentially we know what is the volume inside the tube, and we just want to understand what is the shape of the free surface. And so this is dictated by competition between capillary forces and gravity. And so we can predict essentially what is the shape of the free surface. And then we can essentially cut the structure because this is elastic, and compute what is the final thickness as a function of the azimuthal angle. And so this simple derivation gives us a good way of predicting the shape of the cross section. And so now we have a this thing, right? So we are saying it's completely waiting in our case. So essentially theta zero is parallel to the cylinder. We know the total volume, right? Exactly. We know the total volume there, and we yes, but this we know because of the previous argument, essentially. That we know what the
yeah, the I guess so my question is, what about so how do you estimate or calculate S0 position?
So we get a volume inside the tube, below in the bath, and we impose that theta zero should be parallel to the cylinder. Yeah. Ouais, well, we can discuss later. Well, so there is probably more complicated things which occur in between. So that's for sure. When we are connecting those two arrière, essentially. Ouais. So, to match the two solutions, essentially, we didn't do. Okay, and so essentially it's an easy way to make this kind of tube with an with an asymmetry in the section, and then essentially we can ask what is the shape of the tube when we increase the pressure. And so what we see is that the thin membrane essentially expands, and we observe experimentally that the curvature that we get is quite uniform along the tube. And so we make so we can do this for varying the parameters essentially, so playing with different thickness of the film, different radius, and different elasticity of the tube, and we can make a strong assumption, so essentially that the pressure deforms preferentially the thin membrane, and that the bending is uniform along the axis. And so then we can write the energy of our problem, which is essentially the bending energy of the tube, the stretching, and the work of the pressure. And so we can write the bending energy considering a uniform curvature. The stretching energy, like is given by the hyperelastic model of our tube. And, so because we assume it's incompressible, we only have two directions of stretch. Basically. The third one is given by the incompressibility. And then we can relate the stretching in the longitudinal direction to the one in the radial direction, just with a geometric argument, looking at how so essentially relating those two stretching in the two directions, and then we can minimize the energy to get the variation of the curvature as a function of the pressure. And so if we rescale our different experimental observation with this two scaling, we get something which is quite good in a decade of curvature, basically. And we have a kind of relationship between the curvature and the pressure. So essentially, we can change the residual curvature in the system by increasing the pressure. With on it looks like a power law for a small part. Well, at least we can fit a power law for a small part of the curvature. And so then we are basically in a system in which we have a rod in which we can increase the residual curvature in the system, and so we can play with the curvature versus gravity. So the things that Sébastien is very familiar with, and essentially just taking into account our variation of the curvature with the pressure, we can match essentially the experimental observation with simulation. And so we see that for different film thickness, we get we can look at the variation of the length with pressure, and so we get different critical pressure essentially at which it will start to go up, and we can by putting back our description of the variation of the pressure with the curvature, we can rescale this variation of the length of the tube. Okay, and so then Trevor did experiment, so you can do experiment at a much larger scale, and you can play a little bit with this structure in order to use the forces developed by the tube to move a rigid structure. And essentially, then you can measure what is the force which is applied by this kind of tube when you vary the length for different pressure, and so you can get a structure in which you can tune the stiffness of the structure by changing the pressure inside the tube. Okay. Well, so you can play with initial shapes in order to make like the final shapes which are slightly different. And a last thing that you can control is essentially by playing with the time at which you're injecting the bubble. You can change the drainage time that so the time it will take to drain, the time it will take to drain essentially, and so you will get a thickness in the tube which will be different from one turn to another. And so with this trick you can by increasing the pressure essentially get a structure in which you get the actuation which starts in one and will finish in four, essentially by just changing a little bit the critical pressure at which the structure will start. And yes, so you can do a bunch of other actuation strategies. And so my point here is that it's very elegant way of picking an object. But there are strong limitations, which are that the developed forces are quite small, and that we are also quite limited by the fact that it's interacting with gravity. So it's limited to small structures. And so next question is how can we make stuff which are bigger? And so it's limited because essentially now we are playing with the extensibility of the structure. So the pressure essentially is of the order of the Young modulus of the polymer times the thickness over the width. And so this is a very common way of making grippers. So essentially playing with the fact that a membrane will stretch and will impose a curvature. And so if we want to build a larger structure, a nice idea which was developed across the street is to play with inextensible structures. And so in this case, and this is also used in different actuation mechanism. So in this case, the pressure is not enough to stretch the membrane, but is enough to bend the structure. So the pressure is larger than the stiffness, the flexural stiffness of the structure over W to the cube. And so taking inspiration from the work of Emmanuel Seifert, co-worker, we play with this kind of inextensible fabric, which are sealed. So we thermoseal the fabric, and what we see is that when we increase the pressure in such a structure, the tube will close. And so the curvature essentially of the small part here is amplified when we increase the pressure, and we get the closing of the structure. So we can do numerical simulation to try to see where the deformation goes essentially, and we see that there is a strong localization of the energy in the fold, and we can look at what is the final angle, the target angle, as a function of the initial angle. And we see that the target angle is essentially going linearly with the initial angle. So the over curvature, which has already described by José and Etienne, so we find again this kind of linear relationship between the final angle, the final curvature, and the initial one. Okay, and so we can look at what is happening when we are increasing the pressure. And so what we see is that if we rescale the pressure by the flexural rigidity of the structure, we can collapse all the coiling factors essentially, and that it will saturate if we increase the pressure to about 1,000 times the energy of the of curvature of the structure, and it will saturate towards a given variation of the angle. And so then the question we ask is, can we say something about the mechanics of this structure? So we put the actuator in a force machine, and we measure the moment as a function of the angle. And so you see that the moment is quite non-linear. It's easier to close than to open the actuator, actually. And we can do FEM and also measure the same kind of moment as a function of the angle. And we can try to derive what is the variation. And so essentially the moment goes like the variation of the stretching energy with the angle on P dV phi. And so this term is quite difficult to predict because we don't have a good model of how the stretching energy is localized in the fault. And so we are focusing on the second one. On what we can predict is essentially what is the variation of the volume inside the small portion which is curved. And so for a given initial angle, we get a rest angle, essentially, which is here at 25 degrees. And we can look at how the volume change when the angle is varied. Essentially. And so if we take this into account, just deriving this with respect to phi, we get this variation of the moment, so which is of course lacking this term in order to completely predict what is the variation of the moment, but still gives a good indication of the variation of the moment with the angle. And if we derive again, we get the stiffness. Essentially, so we can linearize essentially close to the rest angle and get the stiffness of the actuator. And what we see is that it scales with the pressure times the width to the cube over pi minus phi naught on term which is essentially constant that we can also derive. And so if we are looking at the torsional stiffness that we measure as a function of PW cube over pi minus phi naught, we get a estimation of the stiffness, and we can also look at the deviation, so essentially the variation with phi naught, and we see that indeed it rockets up when we go towards pi. What?
Did you talk about the hysteresis?
No, we didn't. And so we see the hysteresis in the experiment, okay. And there could be many sources. Yeah. So we impose the pressure inside the system, and there may be some. It may be not completely. Instantaneous, essentially, the variation of the volume inside the tube. Yeah. You're right. This so this is true. But there are other sources of hysteresis. So the material itself is quite hysteretic, and. On the thing is, numerically we don't see it, so we expect that thing to probably come from material properties or something like that. Maybe. What? Phi naught is the initial angle of the. Wait, exactly. Okay. It's always bigger than phi t, yeah? It's always closing. Sure. So I didn't prepare my demo. I
Right. But so now the next thing is what is happening if we play with several of those hinges. And so what we can do is to play with a geometry in which we put these hinges in the form of a star. And what we see is that if we increase the pressure, now we get a radial contraction of the structure. So in the case of a star, no. If we, for example, do a square, we will get a bistable structure. So it's a question that we didn't address carefully, but I think it's an interesting question. And so we get a radial contraction, and we can do a little bit of geometry just looking at what is the variation of the angle, phi I and phi e. And so we have a geometrical relation between those angles. And we make a very simple model in which we are saying that the cube, essentially, they stay rigid, and they are connected by torsional hinges with a given variation of the moment with the angle. And so we can write the energy of the star, which depends on the stiffness of the internal and the external angles, hinges, essentially. And we can minimize the energy, and so we see the variation of the angle at equilibrium as a function of what it would be if there was no connection, so no interaction between the hinges. And what we see is that very quickly, when we increase the number of points of the star, this term will decrease, and so if we start with an angle which should close, the star will completely close also. And so if we play with three arms, essentially it doesn't close completely, but four arms will start to close, and five definitely. And so we can do this numerically, imposing that the initial radius of the star is the same. And so under this constraint, what we see is that the final angle, essentially, first decreases and then increases again because this structure has a larger, essentially, final radius. And so we pick a radius which is around 5 in order to get the maximum contraction of the structure. It's COMSOL.
Ouais.
And so it's... we are playing with shells and symmetry. And yes, so because all these geometrical arguments don't have any scale, essentially you can make structures which are much larger. And so then we asked what is the force that this star is applying on an object. And so what we are doing is that we are indenting with a cone the star. And so if we do a force balance in the system, we can get what is the force which is applied on the object, if we know essentially the coefficient of friction between the glass and the actuator. And we get the force which is applied by the star as a function of the radius for different pressure. And so what we see is that with our simple model, so if we just derive the energy of the star as a function of the radius, we get a stiffness which is not too far from what we see experimentally, but which is slightly lower that we observe. And this is because in the experiment, actually, we employed the opening mode of the actuators, and this is the stiffer mode of the actuator. And so when we linearize, probably we don't take into account the fact that of this non-linear stiffness that we employ in the experiment. Okay, and so because it's easy to make, we can stack them And so because we are in Marseille, we have a pétanque ball in the lab. And so we are able to pick pétanque ball. And because we are in France, we also have a champagne bottle. And because I'm in a granular lab, we also have rocks. And so essentially it's a gripper in which we can pick objects which are slightly heavier than the one we are usually doing with elastomers. And so we can look at how it will scale if we change the typical dimension of the star. So if we just increase all the dimension by a factor eta, keeping the same thickness, the pressure, the operating pressure will decrease in eta cube, and so the stiffness of the star will decrease also as eta square. But if we also scale the thickness of the plate, then it will be the same operating pressure, and the star stiffness will increase by the same factor eta as the geometrical variation. Okay. Good. So the last thing I want to talk about is a more biomechanic problem that we started to look at with a PhD student, Simon Hadjadj, and also biologist from IDDM, so biological development of insects, Raphaël Clément. And so the problem we are looking at is the very initial stage of the deployment of the wing for insects. So when they go out of their pupal stage, essentially, the first thing they do is that they were in a cocoon, and they have wings which are very folded structure, and this structure will deploy in a plane. And so what you can see is that the insect essentially increase his volume, so he's taking some air inside his digestive tract, and you can see the abdomen as a balloon. The volume of the digestive tract increases, so it pressurizes the blood of the insect, which is called hemolymph. And so for a critical pressure, what's happening is that the blood is going inside the structure of the wing on the wing deploys. And then that thing will polymerize, essentially, and the insect does this only once in his life. And so the deployment time is quite fast, is a couple of minutes. And so we are interested in trying to understand what is the mechanics of this problem. And so we can look at the initial organization of the wing, so it looks like an origami, and we can map essentially the position of the big folds in the initial structure to the position of the vein in the final shape. So we have a very folded initial structure, and we can do some microtomography in order to look at how the shape is initially folded. And so what you can see here is a Z-stack of the structure going from one of the edge to the other edge of the structure. And so you can see those kind of very lines. And what you can also see in this structure is that we can see the position of the veins, which are slightly larger tubes inside the folded path. And so we can look at this as markers of the initial length inside the folded structure. And so we can't do this on all the veins, but we can do this on a bunch of veins. So you can see this in this is a real scale, so the initial folded structure on the final one. One question we ask is this transformation conserving the length, or are they a variation of length? Is it like a rigid, inextensible origami which is opened, or is there any stretching in this? And so what we see is that the deployed version, so if we take the arc length there, is 2 times the one of the undeployed one. And so there is some variation of the length when the structure is open. So it could be stretching, but in fact, what we see is that if we go even at a smaller scale and we do some electronic microscopy, so this is a cross section of the vein of the wing, sorry, what you can see is that there are micro wrinkles essentially. So the cuticle, which is something which is slightly stiffer than the cell, is very wrinkled initially. You get some cellular structures on essentially empty space in which the fluid is injected, which is called lumen. On the final stage, when the wing is completely deployed, what we see is that the cuticle completely unstretched. So there is some length without stretching the structure, essentially, which is in the initial system on that that can change the length. And so we are now trying to characterize a little bit of what is the available length in the initial wrinkled structure. And so it's still very preliminary results, but what we see is that the length is enough essentially to match the apparent depth. It's actually even longer with the initial experimental observation that we have. So it looks like it's like a something which is micro wrinkled and that will stretch while the big fold will open. And so the next question we ask is about the flow inside the structure. And so we can see that in the adult wing, so what we do is we inject fluorescent dyes inside the abdomen of the fly, and we see where the blood is going inside the structure. And so when the wing is completely deployed in the adult case, we see that there is flow only in the veins. But during deployment, so this is an insect that just deployed its wing, what we see is that the fluorescent dye goes everywhere in the structure. So the flow is not just inside the veins, but completely flowing in the tube. And so we tried to mimic this process in so here the fly is dead, and what we are doing is that we're injecting liquid inside the body of the fly, and what we see is that indeed we can get something which looks like the expansion of the wing. So we see that the abdomen also grow in volume, but we see also that it's not completely successful for the fly. And what you see is that there is a big bubble, so essentially you are delaminating the two plates, and the fluid is completely invading between the two plates, and we kind of lose the connection between the two plates. And so the next question is we ask is what is holding these two plates together? And if we go back to the observation in microtomography, what we can see is that if we take a cross section in the other direction, we get all those kind of small pillars which are connecting the two plates. And this is something which is very well organized in the structure. And so essentially we get those kind of small pillars which are connecting the two plates together, and which have a typical scale which is well defined. And so probably when we are injecting the fluid, we either impose a too high pressure or maybe the rate at which we are increasing the pressure is too high also, and so we are losing the connection between the plates. And so what we are trying to do now with Simon is to try to connect the mechanical properties of the of this wing with the typical pressure that we observe in the experiment. And so for this, what Simon is doing is stretching So again, this is a dead fly. You can essentially measure the force while imposing a displacement of on the wing, and what you get is that the force essentially increases, but with a very nonlinear variation of the force. And so, a very simple model that we did is to model this as hinges, essentially springs, which are connected by extensional springs, and you can essentially understand this force variation as first unfolding the big folds and then unwrinkling the plates, and then you start to stretch the clique. And so with this very simple model, you can get some kind of ideas of what are the different rigidities at play. And so what we want to do now, but it's in progress, is to connect this back to what we observe when the expansion occurs. I think I will switch. I will finish there, and so I will stress again that the stuff I've presented, what I've presented is done in collaboration with Pierre Thomas Brun in Princeton University, with Trevor Jones, who is a grad student of City, Etienne Jean Maupouillet, and in Marseille, this is the work of Ignacio Andrade Silva, and the wing thing is done also with Ignacio, Simon Adjad, Jean-Victor Charpentier. And I thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Joël, for this impressive talk. And we already raised a lot of questions, but some of you have one or two questions, you're more than welcome to ask.
So in the helices you have in this picture, and I think it was also the case in other movies you showed. I think there is or the chirality changes. At some like in the middle of the helix or something.
Well,
is it something? Yeah, that's called a perversion, I guess. In the something common or?
No,
do you get it all the time, or is it like random, or is it?
We get it a bunch of time. Ouais. We didn't study the condition or whatever. I don't have a good
description. So we'll ask Sébastien. Super.
So in the same, what's the fact that you can't get this little ball higher? What it's the self contact, or you can't? It's gravity, or it's too much in the end.
If you don't get the ball, the thing which will limit you is self contact. Then here you apply force, an additional force. But yes, it's essentially the limit. If you don't get an additional weight, it's self contact.
Okay. Last one.
I mean, you're using pressure always to actuate.
What?
I mean, it's quite flexible. But then again, I mean, you have to attach a nozzle somewhere, and it's also quite error prone in that respect. So,
I'm
wondering, are there plans? You know, for example, changing the local elastic properties, magnetic or
there are many
it more robust.
Working with a different way of actuating.
Okay.
So, one nice thing about the pressure is you get large. It's relatively easy either to stretch the structure or to change the volume and stuff like that. But it's a good question. There should be a more robust way of getting the same kind of
exploiting essentially the same geometrical process, but with a different activation. For example, the overcurvature, you can do something very similar with origamis with folds, like folding papers. On probably, so if you were to actuate the fold in a different way that people have done, probably it's another way of making the.
Okay, thank you again, Joël.
Thanks a lot.